Thank you. loved hearing that. If everyone would now please take a moment to join with me in prayer. O wellspring of eternal life, we come together today to drink deeply from the waters of life. Quench our thirsty souls, refresh our parched spirits, renew us for the living of the transformed life. This we pray in the name of Jesus, the source of living water. Amen. And now we get to look around, greet each other, give a hug, give a handshake.
Thank you. that around the globe, there are places where women spend 70% of their waking hours carrying water from one place to another. Many of them carry the weight of what is 80% of their body weight. It's hard to imagine, but they're doing it because the distance is so great. And I appreciate groups like Our Own Week of Compassion or Living Water International that seeks to build wells closer to where people live. But people are willing to carry, women are willing to carry this water because it's necessary. They are bringing it not just for themselves, but they are bringing it for others. As we reflect on those who literally carry water back to their homes, I want us to think about those in our own lives who have brought us the living water, who have been willing to sacrifice great things to provide us the gifts of God's grace and love. Let us continue to reflect on that as we join in our third song.
Speaking of,
here on what is the first Sunday, not first Sunday, the first day of a new week. And it is always good to gather on the first day of a new week because it gives us the opportunity to begin the work anew. The work of, as our community of faith talks about, putting love first in all things. A new day is ahead of us. A new week is ahead of us. What opportunities are there for us? If you are a visitor with us this morning, what a blessing it is to have you. And I pray that your experience with this community of faith enriches your own faith journey. And it better prepares you to live a life of grace and goodness wherever you might go. I do want to lift up a few things. First of all, our blue cards are back. Things are somewhat returning to normal. But in the bulletins now, the blue cards have returned. We invite you to fill those out, to flip it over, to let us know how we can pray for you in the coming week. And later in the service, you'll be invited to place those in the offering baskets. Today at 1:30, there is an event called Compassionate Communication. It's a free event, workshop that I think would really be a blessing to many folks. It's reflecting on how we speak, how we listen, how we deal with criticism. Our world needs this, folks. And so if you are available, I want to encourage you to come and be a part of this workshop. It'll be just out here in the activity room, again, from 1:30 to 4:30. Today at 5:30 is our general board meeting. At the same time as the board meeting is youth group, both middle school and high school youth, we're meeting here at the church. And then basically a week from today, we start Holy Week, which is the week that leads to Easter. Not Sunday's Palm Sunday, and then we move into Holy Week, and with that comes Maundy Thursday, and this year we have Maundy Thursday services, plural. There is one at 9, 11, 1 p.m., 6 p.m., 7 p.m., and 8 p.m. They're gonna be in the chapel, and so space is limited. So there are sign-up sheets to let us know what service you're coming to so that we don't have 8 people show up at one and one show up at another. So especially if you can come at one of the daytime services, I encourage you to do so. Services will be about 25 minutes and will include communion. So I hope you will participate in that. Maundy Thursday is really the time in Holy Week when we remember the Last Supper Jesus had with his disciples. It's the time that we remember the movement from the upper room to the garden. It's a powerful time. With that, the next day is Good Friday. And again, we're doing things a little different this year, and we're going to be having Good Friday experiences from noon to 2, and then again from 6 to 8 p.m. here in this space. And it's kind of a come as you can. There will be stations that you will sit at, you will interact with, you'll be able to participate. And one of the things is there will be a labyrinth here on the floor. If you've never walked a labyrinth, it is an ancient practice within Christianity. And it's not what people think it is. It's not like a maze where you're trying to get from one point to the other side. A labyrinth has just one path that goes to the center and then you follow the path back out. And it is a way of walking the experience of going inward. And that's so much a part of this season of Lent. It's such an important part of Holy Week. So I hope you will be able to participate either, again, in the afternoon or the evening experiences of Good Friday. And then Easter, a couple weeks away. And we are having a sunrise service at 7:15 in the morning out here in the courtyard. And then services, or usual services, at 9 and 11. With that, we will have Easter lilies. And if you would like to purchase one in memory or in honor of someone, there are slips of paper out there that you can fill out and do so. And then finally, I want to lift up Made for a Miracle. That's a study we're going to do after Easter. It is really, I think, a very powerful book about looking at our own lives and how we can join with God in making some miracles. So again, a lot going on. Today, as we return to the well, we are looking at John's Gospel. What are, at least for some people, some familiar words? They are the story that we often call the woman at the well. And the first line is, Jesus had to go through Samaria. If you read my devotionals, that was the text for my devotional this morning. But it goes on from there. He came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, which was near the land Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. Jesus was tired from his journey, so he sat down at the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to the well to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me some water to drink." Now his disciples had gone into the city to buy him some food. The Samaritan woman looked at Jesus and asked, "Why do you, a Jewish man, ask for something to drink from me, a Samaritan woman?" And then the author of John's Gospel adds this little additional note. Jews and Samaritans did not associate with each other. Goes on, Jesus responded, "If you recognize God's gift and who is saying to you, 'Give me some water to drink,' you would be asking him, and he would be giving you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you don't have a bucket, and the well is too deep. Where would you get this living water? You aren't greater than our father Jacob, are you? He gave us this well, and he drank from it himself. He did so, and so did his sons and his livestock." Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks from the water that I will give will never be thirsty again. The water I give will become in those who drink it a spring of water that bubbles up into eternal life." The woman said to Jesus, "Sir, give me this water so that I will never be thirsty and so that I never need to come here to draw water again." That ends our reading, but I hope our lives can continue to reflect the words of the woman when she said, "Give me this water." You join me in prayer. O source of living water, pour into us the gift of life that Jesus provided. Pour into us the gift that shall quench the thirst that we feel, resolving and transforming the unhealthy desire for those things that are not of you. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. This morning, I am reminded of John Dominic Crossan. He is a scholar, and I appreciated it, and I found it connecting to this scripture. He said the following, "My point, once again, is not that those ancient people told literal stories, and now we are smart enough to take them symbolically. My idea is, they told stories symbolically, and we are now dumb enough to take them literally." Now, Crossan has never been concerned when it comes to stepping on people's toes, when it comes to making a point. But I find those words resonating, especially with this part of John's Gospel. Because what I would describe, some would say literal, I call a one-dimensional reading of Scripture, in this case, leaves out so much. I would suggest it leaves out 99% of the power and meaning that is contained contained in this story. John, the gospel writer, puts the story of the woman at the well immediately after the story of a guy named Nicodemus. The woman, it says, came to the well around noon. And so many people, just reading that part of the passage, start to ask, well, what's wrong with the woman? Why didn't she come earlier when it wasn't so hot? What's wrong? What's going on? But that kind of thinking comes from just reading it one-dimensionally, reading it in just its category all by itself. But when you read it alongside the story of Nicodemus, you begin to see the author's intention. Nicodemus, he comes to Jesus at midnight. The woman, just in the next chapter, comes to the well at noon. Nicodemus, of course, is a man. And the woman, a woman. Nicodemus, well, we know his name because it says it in this story. The woman has no name. Throughout the whole story, she is never named. Nicodemus was a man of authority, of power in the culture. The woman culturally had no power or authority. Nicodemus was a Jew. The woman was a Samaritan. And Nicodemus came to Jesus, where the woman, or Nicodemus came to Jesus, Jesus came to the woman. I don't believe that that all happened by coincidence. Not at all. I think the storyteller here is using a wonderful technique to make a point. He's helping us to glimpse the absolute inclusiveness of a verse that kind of ties the two stories together. It is a verse that you probably know very well. It starts off with, "For God so loved the world." It sits right between these two stories. And though we say, "For God so loved the world," the Greek word that the gospel writer John would have first used is the Greek word cosmos. Cosmos. For those of you that will remember the astronomer Carl Sagan, he had a book and then a TV series called Cosmos. And it's talked about everything from the origins of life to what was beyond the edge of the universe and everything else in between. This word, cosmos, that we find in this passage is connected. Actually, it is what God loves so much. And so when we read those words, we probably should say, "For God so loved absolutely everything known and unknown to us." Now, what's interesting is that Nicodemus, a smart guy, a person who was a part of the elite, a person who was educated, his encounter with Jesus, he doesn't seem to understand. He doesn't catch on. Though eventually he has an epiphany. But it's not an hour later, it's not a day later, it's probably a few years later, because when we really hear about him again, it's after the crucifixion of Jesus. And he comes alongside Joseph of Arimathea, and they anoint the body of Jesus for burial. And it's then that you begin to think that he has had an aha moment in regard to who this Jesus is. The woman at the well, on the other hand, she is one that most people wouldn't have expected to understand what was going on. And she initially has some confusion, as we all probably would have in that moment. But then she has an epiphany. And as she returns to her community, she invites them to come and see, saying to them, "Could this possibly be the saving one of God?" It's John's way of sharing the same message that we teach children. children in the song, Jesus loves the little children. All the children of the world, black and yellow, red and white, they're all precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. There's a guy named Yoros. Yoros owns a ranch. He oversees goats and sheep along the coastline of Greece. He has his ranch at the very place that so many refugees have come ashore. People escaping brutality and killing, trying to escape it, and they come up on the shores there where his ranch is found. He does what he can. Yoros provides food and shelter and water for these folks, dry clothes for them. He said these are human beings and they want the very same things that I want. At the end of the interview with Yoros, he said, the message I want to send is this. Love for all, nothing else. Love for all, nothing else. I believe that the gospel writer John would echo those very same words, love for all, nothing else. In fact, I believe that is exactly what he is doing in the telling of these two stories that sit side by side with that phrase, for God so loved the world, there in the middle. He just does it in a more creative and elaborate way. I imagine that there were some among John's community, those that were receiving this gospel for the first time, who were asking questions, who would Jesus welcome? To whom would Jesus give the life-giving waters? And the answer is found in the juxtaposition of these two stories. These two stories that couldn't be any different. These stories that even have the main character responding to Jesus and the gifts that Jesus is offering in very different ways. Yet in the end, it is hard not to notice the unconditional and boundary-breaking love that is offered. But it doesn't end there. Jesus then says, everyone who drinks the water that comes from Jacob's well will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks from the water that I will give will never be thirsty. The water that I give will become in those who drink it a spring of water that bubbles up into eternal life. Bubbles up into eternal life. So many sermons have been preached on those words, and people say, well, as long as you take in, receive, drink what it is that Jesus is offering, you get to go to heaven. Well, I wouldn't entirely disagree with that, except to say I don't think that was what John's point was at all in sharing these stories together. You may remember me sharing in the past that the language of eternal life, the language of eternity found in John's gospel, really has very little to do with heaven. The word that we translate here is a word that, yes, means that there is no end, but it means eternal in the sense that there also was no beginning. It's that which stands outside of time altogether. The question is not what is eternal, but who is eternal. And the answer is God and God alone. And so when we read about the eternal life or everlasting life, it is the God life. Faith, baptism joins our lives with this life. When you drink from the gift of grace that is given in Jesus Christ, you are joining yourself with this life. Around here, we call it the love first life, but it might be the kingdom life. There's lots of language that you could use here, but it does not begin when we get to heaven. For John, it begins long before then. the moment you connect your life to the one who is eternal. And you remain connected, even at the point of death. I see some similarities in how people approach life and retirement. I hear people say, well, we're postponing that until we retire. We'll get around to that after we retire. That's when we will begin to enjoy life. But the joy God intended for us is not something that is intended just for those who have retired. And the same is true of this idea of everlasting life or the eternal life. It's not just for those who are dead. It is for those who have been in the waters of baptism and, as Paul describes, have been raised up, have experienced the resurrection, who are already in the God life, the one who is eternal. But here's the part that I love about this passage. The water I will give, Jesus says, becomes in those who drink it a spring of water that bubbles up into eternal life. Bubbles up. Sounds a little like Lawrence Welk to me, for those of you who remember Lawrence Welk. It's not traditional Bible language, bubbling up. It only appears three times in all of the New Testament, this one time in John's Gospel and two times in the book of Acts. Both cases in the book of Acts, chapter 3, chapter 14. Someone who was unable to walk is healed. They are helped to their feet. And what happens next is that they jump, they leap, they bound all around. That's the same word that we find in John's Gospel, that spring bubbling up, jumping, leaping. There is an outward expression among those that have been healed, an outward expression of the joy that they have experienced. And it is difficult for it to go unnoticed. And in fact, in the book of Acts, people see it, and they want to know what's behind it. They are intrigued by what they see. Well, those who go to the well and drink, they begin to find something bubbling up within them. Something that begins to leap and jump and to bound all around, so much to the point that others pay attention. Others take note and begin to ask questions. The woman at the well, at first she was a little confused with what Jesus was saying, but something began to bubble up. And when she returned to her community, she offered an invitation to others to come and see. She made a declaration of her faith, and it caught the attention of those in her community. Now, many of you will know the name Oscar Schindler from the movie Schindler's List. He helped save many Jewish people who otherwise would have perished in the Nazi concentration camps. But his story is not the only one like that. There were others. And one that I have enjoyed reading about for years is the story of Karl Lutz. Karl was a Swiss diplomat who was assigned to Hungary, Budapest, shortly before the Nazis invaded. Now, Karl was a part of the Methodist tradition. And as a young boy, he had a transformative faith experience. And he said that in that transformative experience, he asked God to give him a special mission. Now, that special mission did not come around immediately. But Karl would later say that God answered it when he assigned him to Budapest, because Jews came to him asking for help. He couldn't ignore their plight. There were those who were already being taken to Auschwitz. Rumors had it that they were being killed. And so Karl Lutz went to the Nazis and asked them for 8,000 diplomatic letters of protection. And the Nazis gave them to him. And he began to assign these protective letters. Now it's interesting, the Nazis did not consider Jews humans. They were called units. But Karl Lutz took advantage of that language because he didn't just look at the individuals, he looked at them as family units. And he assigned one letter not to an individual, but to an entire family. But when he got to 7,999 letters of protection being given out, he started over with one, hoping the Nazis would not see the duplication, and they didn't. And historians estimate that Karl Lutz saved 62,000 people from the gas chambers. A faith experience as a young boy. Something began to bubble up within him, bubbling up to eternal life, to the God life, to the love first life, to the kingdom life, bubbling up into a passion to live a God mission, one that was unmistakable. Not only did others see it, but they too experienced it. As one Jewish woman said who was saved, when someone risks his life for you, you are forever changed. It is an amazing and powerful story, and yet most of us will not find ourselves in a similar situation. We probably won't find ourselves in one of those life or death experiences, but that does not mean that others shouldn't see something bubbling up within us. Just ask those young people out in Boys and Girls Country. Just ask those women in the prison that our group goes and works with on a weekly basis. Ask those who are trafficked in the sex industry and receive a phone call from one of our people, a phone call of hope. Just ask those who receive Meals on Wheels from someone who volunteers down in NAM from this congregation. Just ask those people, and they will probably speak about seeing something bubbling up in the lives of these other people, bubbling up into the eternal life, the God life, the kingdom life, the love first life. In Matthew 10, Jesus says, give a cool cup of water to someone who is thirsty. By doing the smallest act of giving, you will be a true disciple. What I think you will find is that it's not as hard as you think it is. It's not the effort or as cumbersome as you might think. For when you drink the life-giving gift that is Jesus Christ, when you take in the grace and the love of our God, something begins to bubble up. And it's not our own doing, because the very nature of those gifts cannot be contained or controlled by anything we say or do. We go to the well for ourselves, but what we take away is a gift for someone else as well. That woman, she went to the well not expecting anything special. But if you ask those that she encountered back in her own community, those who heard her invitation to come and see, if you were to talk to those who heard her declaration of faith, I am pretty certain you would hear the voices and you would see in those people an experience of someone who was touched by the grace of God bubbling up in the life of another. Now the question for us today is, how about us? What will people see in us? How about tomorrow morning? Because you were here in worship today, because you heard about the gifts of God's grace and love, because those gifts were poured into you, what will people see bubbling up in you? will they be able to see something radically different about who you are? Will they, like those in that woman's community, will they say, there is something different about this person? I believe they will, not only individually, but collectively. For we touch the lives of so many. And yet what I find over and over again is people who do the work, who are out there doing grace-filled work, they talk about how it's not all that hard. They often say, I give more than I receive. It's because they've gone to the well, and because they have been filled to overflowing, because those gifts are bubbling up, because it's the very nature of the gift. It cannot be contained, and it spills out on the lives of so many. Now go. Not yet. But be prepared to go from this place, filled to overflowing, because there is someone that you will meet who hasn't been able to get to the well, and you carry within you that very gift. Let's pray. O gift of living water, we come together to drink from the abundance of your grace. We come together to taste and to experience the fullness of what you offer. Holy and loving God, fill us with your gifts. May the generosity that you offer, the way you pour forth so much into our lives, may we receive it, may we enjoy it, may we celebrate it, but may we allow it to do what it always does. May we allow it to bubble up within us. May we allow it to pour forth from us as we interact with others who are maybe needing a little time at the well, but they just can't get there. May we act like your well, not because of anything we have done, but because of the generosity of your grace that you have poured into us. May it pour forth. May it be a blessing. It is joy that is unspeakable. It is love that is unstoppable. It is these things that well up within each of us this day. We pray, God, that we will do nothing to hold them back, but that we may open up our lives and let them pour forth. We ask these things in the name of your wonderful gift, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Today we have a happy song for you, a bubbling up song, and it's participatory. I'm hoping I can say that. And when we get to the part that says joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible, I really hope that you will join us and sing.
There's another fairly well-known story, though not from scripture, but from culture. Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire. There's a line where Dumbledore says, "The time is coming when we will need to make the choice between what is right and what is easy." I would suggest that doing what is right, what is filled with love, what is gracious, may not be as hard as we think, because technically it's not something that we are creating within ourselves. It is something that has been gifted to us, that is already bubbling up, that's already trying to make its way out upon the world. The meal that we share in every Sunday is an experience of that abundant grace of God. For this table does not belong to us. It is God's. It is Christ Jesus. And it is his invitation that brings us together. You don't need to be a member of our church. You may be of one place on the journey of faith, and I may be in another, but Jesus says, come and feast, believing that there is something powerful in the welcome and in the sharing of the meal. For those of you in the main part of the sanctuary here, you'll be coming forward in just a moment, taking a piece of bread, dipping it in the cup, and partaking of the elements. For those of you on the back row, communion will be brought to you, along with offering trays. I want to encourage you, as you do either come forward or sit on the back row, is to have your blue cards, your offering, place them in there, because this is a community that takes seriously the prayer concerns that you offer. Know that all are welcome to participate in this meeting. Let us now join our voices as we sing together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thank you.
words wealth effect, but I fear that that culturally maybe would not connect with everyone. But there is something from that wonderful gift that does bubble up within us and can be such a blessing to others. As we do every Sunday, we extend an invitation. It is an invitation to be a part of a community of faith. And if that is something you are looking for, this is a wonderful, quirky, strange, what? I'm the center of it all in that I'm the quirkiest. But we would love to have you as a part of this congregation. But it's also an invitation to connect your life most importantly to Jesus Christ. And if you wish to respond to that, you can either come forward as we are singing, or you can meet one of our pastors or elders in the back door. Let us now join in our voices.
Thank you.
come to one of the Monday, Thursday services, but also about the Compassionate Communication Workshop at 1:30 today. I hope you'll consider coming. Now grab the hand of somebody close. And let us join together in our closing prayer. Gracious God, may your love and our lives come together in the life lived in love. May Jesus be our mentor and our model. And may the world see in us a life that is willing to put love first in all things. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.